بلش هلا؟ May the House please come to order. Welcome to Amen XX's opening ceremony. Now, can everyone please rise for the Jordanian national anthem? Madam Secretary General, Deputy Secretary Generals, and fellow Secretariat, respected MUN directors, student officers, delegates, and the entirety of the Amen family. To start off, in honor of this year's theme, Accountability for Stability, please enjoy our opening video prepared by the Amen media team.
Glenn, do you take responsibility for that?
Yeah, no, I don't take responsibility at all.
I think it is important to make it clear that no one in our country is above the law. And if the president violates the law, he has to be held accountable. No society, no economy can function without a rule of law.
We're with the bomb disposal team. We were going around Gaza collecting rockets and missiles. Some of them are unexploded, some of them are in residential areas. And as there were 11 days of attacks, there's still a lot of work to do.
War crimes, genocide, crimes against humanity are not acceptable. And if anyone tries to commit such crimes or commit such crimes, then they will be punished. They will be held accountable for those actions.
It's as if I talk about responsibilities, everyone is silent, just like they are now. It's silent and not moving, right? Focusing, attentive. Say, pick up your responsibility. Pick up the heaviest thing you can and carry it.
We must hold nations accountable in order to achieve stability.
Now, if everyone will help me in welcoming a member of the Amman Baccalaureate School community, a member of the Amman Baccalaureate School community for the past 28 years, our principal, Ms. Basman Nimri.
مساء الخير واهلا وسهلا فيكم بمدرسة البكالوريا عمان. Good evening. Madam Secretary General, ladies and gentlemen, delegates and colleagues, Welcome to the first hybrid Amman Baccalaureate MUN conference, the 20th Amman conference to be organized and led by ABS students. 20 years ago, two very enthusiastic students who loved debate dreamed about introducing Model United Nations into their school in Jordan. I still vividly remember Luma Qadoumi and Hashem Dabbas, who not only managed to fulfill their dream, but also to have left a wonderful legacy that has now become part and parcel of the educational fabric of the best schools in Jordan and around the world, involving thousands of students throughout the years, providing them with the opportunity to become more aware of the world issues around them, and gathering them to discuss these issues with great passion. I still remember a high-profile United Nations diplomat who once attended one of the Amun conferences and spoke about how the world would certainly be in a far better position if politicians have the same passion as these young adults who debate, discuss, and try to find solutions to world issues. Today, as we are celebrating Amun's 20th anniversary, I'm so happy to see the growth of the MUN conference experience in Jordan and in the area. And just like every year, participating delegates never cease to amaze me. For this year's conference, we are very happy to have no less than 320 participants, delegates participating from 17 schools. At least one third of them are representing international schools from around the world. I would like to extend a very special warm welcome to the delegates from schools in Lebanon, Palestine, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Bahrain, Armenia, and all the way from the United States in San Diego. In addition, a very warm welcome goes to the delegates from 9 schools here in Amman, Jordan. And of course, we should not forget to welcome our own delegates from the Amman Baccalaureate School. I would like to also acknowledge the presence of not only the delegates, but also the school supervisors who are with us today attending this conference. Seeing all of you here today, whether physically or virtually, so full of enthusiasm and determination to continue to make a difference in your societies and in the world around you, is a reminder that the Model United Nations is indeed an amazing experience that will surely leave a positive impact on you all. The fact that you are all here with us today is entirely due to our extremely dedicated and politically aware students who work so hard every year in organizing this conference to make this experience a true success to all of you. The Secretariat, the presidents of all the prestigious forums have all been working tirelessly, facing unprecedented challenges to produce relevant topics and crisis issues related, ready for you to talk in through your resolutions. I would like to specifically acknowledge all of these students in the Amun leadership team and our hosting MUN director, Mr. Majed Mahamre, and all the other staff who support this conference. A huge thank you goes to each and every one of you for working against the odds, for having to think of solutions to problems that were never faced before, and most of all, for your determination of not allowing something like a worldwide pandemic to rob you of this wonderful experience. Although I do not want to tread on the toes of the speakers to come, I would like to say a few words about the conference theme for this year, which is accountability for stability. So, what does it mean to be accountable? Accountability refers to the willingness to accept responsibility for one's actions. When we accept responsibility, we are then committed to generating positive results. And when this concept is spread at a much larger scale, then societies will surely benefit and move forward. We cannot afford to turn a blind eye anymore to decisions made by certain people in power that lead to human rights violations, environmental concerns, or socioeconomic issues in many parts of the world. Surely, there will be no stability if people are not held accountable. I would like here to quote the chairperson of the Kenyan Commission of Human Rights, Florence Sambiri, who said, "Peace cannot exist in a vacuum. Bringing those with the highest responsibility to account will bring stability. Citizens will respect the law more if they see that the law can be applied equally to everyone." End quote. So, as you start your discussions and as you go on with your lives, I want to leave you with these words. Don't ever think you're too young to act and make a difference. Don't think that one person will not be able to create a positive change. Dr. Martin Luther King said, "Your life begins to end the moment you start being silent about the things that matter." I take this further and tell you, your life begins to end when you stay in the shadows and take no action that you know will make the life of even one person better. So, remain at the forefront. Be informed. Don't be afraid to take the roads that have not been taken before. Understand what is going on in the world and take action. Thank you, and I wish you an enjoyable experience.
Thank you very much, Ms. Besma. The Amman Model United Nations prides itself on being the only Thymen-affiliated conference in Jordan. And for the past 20 years, we have lobbied, debated, and hosted both local and international students. In celebration of this diversity, please put your hands together for our organizing team.
And then it goes back, and then it goes. When I get older, I will be strong.
Now, if you'll all please help me in welcoming our Madam Deputy Secretary General, Karma Al-Aloul. Karma, the floor is yours.
Your Excellency, Mr. Ziad Sheikh, Madam Secretary General. Sorry. Your Excellency, Mr. Ziad Sheikh, Madam Secretary General, fellow Secretariat, esteemed guests, and of course, delegates, the world has always been fascinated by the crisscrossing lines of the letter X. From scaring algebra students to marking a pirate's gold, the letter X represents the most frightening, the most exciting, and the most fascinating parts of our lives. To find X is to find a solution to a problem. We're all the X to economic, humanitarian, political, and environmental problems. We are the youth that will take on one mathematical equation at a time. We are the unremitting force solving X after X after X. Delegates, I want you to find the X to the 29 global issues you will address throughout the conference. Student officers, I want you to find the X to disorder in the House. Organizers, I want you to find the X to technical issues you might encounter. Despite this, X is not any solution. It's exclusive and strong. It's ambiguous, variable, and multifarious. It's specific, unmistakable, and daring. That is what your solutions should be. And my hopes are that the Amman Model United Nations is the tool that will make you and your solutions all of the above. It might sound complicated, so I want to remind you that the increasingly complex problems of the world have embarrassingly simple solutions. Accordingly, go back to original treaties, find the root of the problem, or even manage the symptoms of world plagues. Think simple, youthful, and most importantly, powerful. I ask that you bring this power with you to the conference, to foster a sense of community, diversity, and stability. I also ask that you mark this part of your MUN journey with a big X, whether the start, intermediate, or end. Not the type of X signifying an error or cancellation, nor the one communicating conflict nor contrariness, but the type that marks your treasure. I have faith that Amun will be your map to the golden nugget or even a jackpot, whether that's a realization, an understanding, or the fulfillment of a goal in your life. Actually, make that two goals, two golden nuggets, and two X's. Welcome to Amun XX.
Thank you, Karma. Now, please join me in welcoming Mr. Deputy Secretary General, Jad Layoush. Jad, the floor is yours.
Your Excellency, Mr. Ziad Sheikh, Madam Secretary General, Madam Deputy Secretary General, fellow Secretariat, honorable board members, esteemed guests, and most importantly, delegates. Emerging from the shadows is a new generation of citizens that are carrying a new series of crises, a new set of obligations that will dictate a dystopia from a utopia. The fear of the unknown that the future holds and the surprises of conflict that may come your way and are now in your hands. Amid the chaos both within and beyond this region, the concepts of conflict and war have only become clearer, and the need for peace and security even more dire. As a generation, we experienced the wake of the worldwide COVID-19 pandemic, witnessing firsthand the difficulty of facing it. And while it challenges us to look at things in a different way, it helps us to look ahead past this difficult moment to a time when we, and hopefully the world, will have healed. In the meantime, we step foot into our journey as UN personnel. For 20 years, Amun has been able to uphold its reputation of being one of the leading conferences in the region. Even in these troubling times, because of you, the delegates, with your diversity and commitment to debate. It is with great honor I present to you Amun's first ever hybrid conference. For I can see the courage in your eyes, which over the course of the next 3 days, I expect you to fill the rooms of the 11 forums, where you will take on the roles of world leaders and policymakers. Within the next 3 days, I would urge you to learn delegates not only in the debate rooms, but also through the vast possibility of cultural exchange. Each of you have the valor to explore the possibility of your capabilities, and I would encourage you to do so. It is now up to you to make use of this platform provided here at AMEN, to bring forth your ideas, to exercise diplomacy, and take action upon your thirst for change reasonably. Immerse yourselves into the world of politics, yet remember to always respect your opponents as well as your allies. Stand your ground and make the effort to get your points across, for we all here come to solve worldwide tribulations. So be smart, be considerate, work hard, and have courage, delegates. Thank you.
Thank you, Jad. As for this year's keynote speaker, we would like to present His Excellency Mr. Ziad Sheikh. Ziad Sheikh holds the prestigious position of the UN Women Representative in Jordan. Mr. Sheikh served as the UN Women Representative in Nepal, leading the UN Women's response to the earthquakes that Nepal saw that period. Also during this period, he served as the acting country director for UN Women in Egypt. Before this, he served as UN Women's Resource Mobilization Lead in New York and led the drafting process of the organization's first corporate resource mobilization strategy and its first corporate private sector strategy. In addition to this, he served as UNIFEM's Deputy Country Director in Afghanistan and went on to work with UNICEF in designing and implementing global, regional, and country-level policy advocacy strategies and campaigns for girls' education and maternal health, particularly in collaboration with UNICEF India. Aside from Mr. Sheikh's work in the UN scheme, he worked with Save the Children UK and the Center of Islamic and Middle Eastern Laws at the University of London. Mr. Sheikh, the floor is yours.
Thank you. And I hope you can see me. It's great for me to address a man of the Amman Baccalaureate. I'm the patron of the system I have been. I extend my congratulations to the Amman Baccalaureate's milestone and to the entire.
Mr. Sheikh, unfortunately, your connection is breaking up and we can't hear you properly.
Is this any better?
Yes.
Okay. Should I start?
If you could repeat from the beginning, please. Sorry.
Thank you for a warm welcome. It's a great pleasure and honor to be of the Imam Bakr School under the patronage of the Prophet bint Al Hassan. And I extend my congratulations to the memory principal of the Imam Bakr School and to teach. It is inspiring to see so many represented. Addressing issues of future.
I'm sorry to interrupt again, but the connection hasn't improved.
I'm not sure if there's anything I can do. I'm going to try this. Is that any better?
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
We're very sorry.
No, my apologies. I'll continue from where I left off, just in the interest of time. I was really just thanking you for the very warm welcome, congratulating the school and the delegates for what looks like an incredibly interesting and very, very relevant series of issues you will be discussing and debating and hopefully finding some solutions for during your conference. The theme, accountability for stability, is indeed a crucial one. And at UN Women, accountability is at the heart of the realization of women's rights. There is no shortage of evidence and data to show gender inequalities remain deeply entrenched in every society. And the lived realities of women across the world provide a powerful yet worrying narrative to complement these facts and figures. Moreover, these inequalities have far-reaching and long-lasting ramifications, not just for these women, but for all of us. As such, all the topics to be discussed in the various intergovernmental bodies of your conference will need each of you to consider and reflect on how gender is central to not only understanding the problems, but also to designing just, inclusive, and sustainable solutions with the fair representation of women's voices. The question of gender inequality in the workplace that will be discussed in your Human Rights Council is particularly timely. Women's economic empowerment is central to realizing women's rights and gender equality. You have also probably heard that it is also a smart thing to promote, because when more women work, economies grow. Yet around the world, women are less likely to participate in the labor market than men. Globally, over 2.7 billion women are legally restricted from having the same choice of jobs as men. Prior to the COVID-19 pandemic, the women's global labor force participation rate was at its lowest, at 48.5%. This is 26.5 percentage points below the rate of men's participation. Despite notable progress in the last few years, the economic gender gap in the Middle East and North Africa region remains one of the largest in the world. And the region's female labor force participation rate is the lowest globally, estimated at 20% in 2019. Many factors contribute to this low participation rate, including social norms, employer discrimination, and poor job conditions. There are other factors. On average, women earn 77% of what men earn. Women are still less likely to have access to social protection and financial institutions. Women are also constrained from achieving leadership and decision-making positions. And gender-based violence, first and foremost a human rights violation, is yet another factor often preventing women to enter and stay in the labor market. The economic costs, a reflection of the human and social costs, to the global economy of discriminatory social practices and institutions and violence against women is estimated to be approximately $12 trillion annually. The COVID-19 pandemic has exacerbated pre-existing gender inequalities and laid bare weaknesses in the already fragile global care economy. Globally, in 2019 and 2020, women lost 54 million jobs. Even before the pandemic, they took on 3 times as much unpaid care work as men. By way of example, estimates based on time use data for Jordan show that the unpaid work demands on women's time increased dramatically under the pandemic conditions,
reaching an unsustainable total workload of 80 to 85 hours per week. Due to school closures, suspension of market services, higher vulnerability of the elderly, and risk of illness. And despite women's greater vulnerability to poverty, only 23% of social protection policy and labor market measures adopted to respond to COVID-19 consider their specific needs. As a result, it is estimated that by the end of 2021, men's jobs will have largely recovered, but there will still be 13 million fewer women in employment. Where do we go from here? The world needs a comprehensive response to this problem, one that will take a coordinated, people-centered approach to recovery in both developed and developing countries, making a conscious effort to put women front and center. One that will ensure that there is accountability. For example, by removing obstacles to women's work, by promoting flexible working arrangements, by ensuring fair opportunities for women to take on leadership and decision-making roles, and by ensuring their contributions, paid and unpaid, are fully acknowledged. This is a moment for governments to recognize both the magnitude of the contributions women make and the precarious situation so many of them live in. There needs to be a focus on sectors where women are overrepresented and underpaid, such as daily wage earners, small business owners, those working in the cleaning, caring, and catering sectors, and in the informal economy. But more than anything else, the response needs to ensure the change is sustainable so that women and girls can live in a world where they can expect to access job opportunities through skills, resources, social capital, and networks. And how can we do this? COVID-19 provides us with an opportunity for radical positive action to redress long-standing inequalities in multiple areas of women's lives. There is scope not just for resilience, but for recovery, growth, and empowerment. A simulation analysis of COVID-19 policy responses finds that over 150 million women and girls could emerge from poverty if governments implemented comprehensive strategies to improve access to education, ensure fair and equal wages, and expand social transfers by 2030. To realize this, the UN and UN Women is calling for better policy, stronger action, and greater investment. Investing in the care economy and social infrastructure, such as the expansion of quality care services to create jobs and increase support for unpaid caregivers. Public investment in care services could create 40 to 60% more jobs than the same investment in construction. Secondly, promoting women's leadership across institutional spaces, from governments to civil society and the private sector, especially in responding to a crisis. And thirdly, increasing funding for women's organizations. Despite their critical roles as watchdogs and in providing a social safety net for vulnerable communities, women's organizations are woefully underfunded. Distinguished delegates, every day diplomats and decision makers are working to resolve crises and develop solutions to govern our ever more complex world. Today and during the days ahead, it will be your turn. As the world's future leaders and decision makers, explore and to find solutions through your unique insights with aspirations for a better future. If there is one idea I would hope you will take away from this speech, it is the principle of inclusion. Inclusion of the specific needs of women and girls in all the topics you will address in your debates. Inclusion of gender responsive solutions, that could maximize the impact for all, not just for some. An inclusion of global norms and standards on gender equality and women's empowerment to hold countries accountable to their national and international commitments. And the inclusion of women's voices as equal partners in the decision-making process. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sheikh. A few of our student officers have prepared questions for you. So first, we will have a question from the Deputy President of the Economic and Social Council.
I wanted to ask, who in your opinion should be held accountable for the systematic misogyny that is present in our society?
Would you like me to repeat the question?
Yes, please, I didn't quite hear that.
Who in your opinion do you think should be held accountable for the systematic misogyny that is present in our society?
I'm sorry, I'm still not hearing the delegate's question.
The question was, who in your opinion should be held accountable for the systemic misogyny that's present in our society?
The systemic what, sorry?
Misogyny.
Misogyny, okay, I have that. Thank you. Would you like me to take each question as they come?
What suits you better? We can do both first. Okay. The next question is from the Deputy President of the Environmental Commission.
What advice can you give to students who wish to pursue a similar career to yours?
Those are the questions.
Thank you very much, delegates, for the question. On the issue of misogyny, I started my career with the United Nations, working with UNICEF on girls' education. And I then still strongly believe that education is a crucial foundation building a fairer, more inclusive, just society. But I learned somewhat later in my career that there are numerous other factors that have to be addressed simultaneously to address pervasive issues of gender inequality, discrimination against women, and including issues of misogyny. Education is paramount. It's crucial that children from an early age, all children from an early age in every society, are seeing women and men, boys and girls equally in how they're depicted in the home, in the public domain, in all spheres of life. I think a key issue for all of us to tackle here in Jordan and the wider region and globally is how our education curricula depict women. Far too often, we will see women depicted in the household, undertaking household chores, care-related chores. And this instills a deep and often very difficult to change understanding amongst young children of the roles that men and women can and indeed should not play. And I think many of these issues are at the foundation of how we then go on as we grow to treat each other as adults. And if these issues are not addressed from a very, very early age, in school, in the household, then we will continue to perpetuate the notion that women are less than men, that women are unequal to men. And these issues are, unfortunately, at the heart of misogynistic practices. So education is crucially important, but so are many, many other issues. And it's very, very difficult work, but they all must be addressed simultaneously. On the second question, I mentioned that I started my career with the UN, with UNICEF, working on girls' education. But I think, and I come back to the response to my first question, I think what we go on to do in later life is very often, if not invariably, shaped by what we see from a very, very early age, what we see and experience from a very, very early age. Some of us have opportunities to change that, many don't. I was fortunate enough to have diversity as the norm in my early years, in my formative years. I grew up in a part of the world where diversity was not always celebrated and sometimes was challenged. But diversity was the norm. And I grew up having the opportunity to experience and appreciate diversity of opinion, diversities of views, even when they conflicted with the ones that I held then. And I had diversity in my background. I come from Irish, Pakistani heritage, two very different parts of the world, which at the same time share many, many things in common. So I think whether you're looking to play a role in an organization like the UN or to be a responsible citizen who takes the issue of accountability seriously, then I think exposing yourself to different opinions, to diverse opinions, as you're going to be doing, no doubt, during the next few days, and trying to understand those, not necessarily agree with those, but trying to understand those and trying to work out why it is this person has a very different and sometimes conflicting opinion to mine, is going to be incredibly important, not just for positive, constructive, and respectful dialogue, but to find in sustainable solutions for all of the issues and many, many more that you'll be debating during the next few days of your conference.
Thank you, Mr. Sheikh. Nadia, on mute. Thank you, Mr. Sheikh. If you don't mind, we have one more question for you from the Chair of the Security Council.
What challenges does the UN Women's Mission face, especially in a world dominated by men?
I think I heard that. Well, what challenges does the UN face in a world dominated by men?
The question was, what challenges do you face in the UN Women, specifically seeing as the world is like, we live in a male-dominated society, like a patriarchal society?
A patriarchal society?
Yes.
Thank you. This issue comes full breadth of the work of the UN. Institutions like I work for, UN Women. But issues of patriarchy, of course, and ones of gender inequality are largely, if not exclusively, rooted in issues of power and power relations. We see this within and across the UN system itself. We see this in the need to continue to reform the United Nations system so that it better reflects today's reality and indeed the aspirations of the generation of tomorrow and the generation that will come after it. So I would suggest that there are two important ways of needing to address this question. One is an external facing question. And here, again, recognizing deep-rooted inequalities on a range of levels does help to perpetuate patriarchal norms and to continue to sustain power of a few and enable them to hold that power over others. But I think very, very importantly is the continued need to both invest in multilateralism, in terms of respect for the rule of law, respect for diversity of citizenry and their opinions, but also in terms of countries and member states holding not only themselves accountable, but the multilateral system as a whole accountable. Because it's only fundamentally these issues of a strengthened and reformed United Nations system, and by the United Nations system, I am referring to the 194 member states, that we continue to strive to be representative of the people that we serve, and to recognize that both within and beyond our borders, patriarchy is deep-rooted. It is hugely detrimental to human rights and the peace and prosperity of all nations. And that by addressing patriarchy, by demonstrating that it is fundamentally at odds with the Charter of the United Nations, does require all men in decision-making roles and beyond to show a different way. So that includes all of us here today attending this conference. It includes all male leaders across the world. It includes all fathers in the household. Again, referring to how these notions of inequality, power relations between genders, are formulated and embedded from a very, very early age.
Thank you very much. This concludes our question and answer session. We would like to send our sincere gratitude to His Excellency Mr. Ziad Sheikh for joining us. Now last but definitely not least, I would like to present the Madam Secretary General, Rene Dabas. Rene, the floor is yours.
Your Excellency, Mr. Ziad Sheikh, Madam and Mr. Deputy Secretary Generals, AMNXX leadership team, student officers, organizers, guests, and of course, delegates. It is my utmost honor and privilege to officially welcome you all to the 20th annual Amman Model United Nations. As we gather here today, some of us online and some of us on campus, it is yet again that time of the year when we can all tune out from our phones and social media and tune into the world around us, confronting our current reality. From the Boko Haram insurgency in Nigeria, all the way to the inequitable distribution of COVID-19 vaccines, if we listen close enough, we can hear a cry for help. I am aware that you have all heard the phrase, "You are the future, the good and the bad depends on you," countless of times in the past. However, I hope you all understand that the repetition of this statement does not make it any less valuable or true. Instead, it's as important as ever. As I stand here before you all, the delegates of today and the leaders of tomorrow, I can confidently say that you all are capable of making a difference. I don't want you all to look at yourselves as 300 individuals out of 7.8 billion. Because that is merely a number. Instead, I want you all to look at yourselves as skilled, passionate students who are that carry great potential to make our world a better place. Growing up, the names of influential individuals such as Martin Luther King Jr., Malala, and Ruth Bader Ginsburg have been repeated many times, whose actions and accomplishments might make us feel small or insignificant. However, at a point in their lives, these individuals were in the exact same position as you all are today. They all started somewhere. And delegates, AmenXX is the perfect start to your journeys of becoming the household names that future generations will look up to. At Amen, students from all over the world are given a platform to be the change they wish to see. At Amen, delegates are able to learn, grow, and broaden their perspectives on what it means to be global citizens and agents of change. And this year specifically, delegates will understand the grave importance of accountability. As famous author Bob Proctor once said, accountability is the glue that ties commitment to results. And as delegates about to enter AmenXX, I want this quote to resonate with you all. Accountability inspires confidence, legitimacy, and responsible action, which brings us one step closer to achieving the goal that unified us all here today: change for the better and greater good of our international community. In our diverse selection of forums, topics revolving real issues, real crises, and real people are within your hands. The need for accountability must be stressed, and I want you all to recognize that without accountability, nothing can be achieved. We need accountability for stability, and delegates, it is now your duty to uphold this concept. And so, whether you've come to Amen because of your immense passion for MUN, or whether this is your first ever conference and are still unsure if MUN is something you want to pursue, I heartily encourage you all to learn from this experience. In fact, I urge you all to debate your hearts out and be confident in your views and opinions. I hope that what you take away today, tomorrow, and the day after is something you can carry forever. Delegates, the 20th annual Amman Model United Nations awaits you all. Therefore, without further ado, I officially open AmenXX.
Thank you, Rena. Before sending you off to your forums, we would like to take time to familiarize you with some housekeeping points. To do so, I welcome to the stage our head organizers, Nadia Hamdan and Farah Masadi.
Good afternoon, Amen leadership team, organizers, student officers, delegates, and esteemed guests. On behalf of the AmenXX team, we would like to welcome you all to our 20th annual conference. It's our intention to make our setting as safe as possible for all who have decided to participate. To ensure a safe conference, we would like to remind you of the COVID-19 procedure and housekeeping notes you must abide by. We ask that the following general rules and guidelines are adhered to throughout the entire conference by all students, staff, guests, and visitors.
While participating in the Amen Conference, delegates have the responsibility to always maintain the highest level of professionalism, whether it be in speech, appearance, or actions, including on social media and electronic communications. It is expected that all participants will respect the property of the school. We would like to remind you that all clothing worn by all participants must adhere to the guidelines portraying professionalism and modesty.
To protect everyone's health and safety, please practice social distancing. Keep a distance of 2 meters between you and other participants at all times. Do not cluster at any point during the conference. Wear your mask at all times. Sanitize your hands regularly, and hygiene bottles will be distributed to all forums. Refrain from sharing any object such as, but not limited to, pens, papers, notebooks, and others. Bring your own water bottle. Avoid contacting other participants in other forums during the span of the conference. Have a soft copy of your vaccine certificate or your negative PCR test present at all times.
To ensure a clean environment, please throw all your trash in the trash can. Use the spray bottles provided to clean and sanitize your space after each day. Do not litter, avoid drinking or eating any liquids or solids other than water in all forms.
Participants must be a role model for themselves and others by coming to the meeting with a positive attitude, arriving promptly to the meetings and from breaks, presenting themselves in a positive manner, and respecting themselves and all other participants. Amin has strict rules regarding personal behavior. Drinking is forbidden. The use of illicit drugs, cigarettes, electronic cigarettes, and other tobacco products are prohibited. Any issues related to substance abuse or use will be immediately directed to the school's administration and or the responsible MUN director to ensure that measures are taken if such individual is found guilty of misconduct.
We are confident that all participants have the highest moral standards. We trust that the rules and guidelines will be adhered to throughout the interim of the conference. In the event of a fire or any other emergency, please take note of the exit doors relevant to your location. In the event of an emergency, do not panic. Stay calm and focused, and follow the directions given by the adults in charge. The use of elevators is prohibited during an emergency, so please take note of the nearest stairwell if you are on an upper floor.
Establishing essential agreements is necessary, and so we hope that our message has been clearly passed on. We encourage you all to take safety precautions. However, don't forget to enjoy yourselves. We're confident that you'll take full advantage of this unique opportunity in a responsible manner.
Once again, welcome to the Amin XX Conference. We look forward to the following weekend. We are confident that by working together, we will be able to bring positive change to the near future. We wish you all the best.
Okay, I am now going to call the president and chairs of each forum down, and all the delegates in that forum follow your presidents out of the theater. So first, the president of GA3, please come to the stage, and delegates of GA3, please follow your president. If you're not in GA3, please stay seated.